So here the title of my presentation is The Right Man in the Right Place, because Huarte is one of the first author who connects very directly, very explicitly education with the role and activity in the state and the possibility to be useful for public life. This is one of the commonplace of Renaissance education concerning the prince, concerning the ruling class, but it was new to say that all men of all social classes had to be useful to the state, and that their ability to contribute was determined by their right address, right correspondence between talents and activity. And this talent had to be assessed on the with a medical protocol, because according to Huarte, who was a physician, it was only the body, and especially the theory of temperament, which was completely fully responsible of our personality, talents, and abilities. And I focus on the concept of education, the concept of pre-eugenics, because Huarte devotes one chapter, the final chapter of his work, on how to procreate, how to bear children with given characters, and the role of the brain, which, according to Huarte, is fully concentrated on the material nature of the brain. So the soul loses with Huarte all its metaphysical and immortal character, and the soul faculties are located physically in the brain and are conditioned by temperaments. Here we can I summarize here that the concept of ingenium, that this is not a new concept, of course, was developed during the 15th century to explain individual attitudes and talents. But in work about education, normally went on speaking the same, elaborating on the same concept by Plutarch in De Liberis Educandis, so that youth was very hot, youth was full of imagination and of passions, and this passion had to be disciplined to education. They didn't go further or develop it in a larger way. And in the second half of the 16th century, it was politics that required not anymore only the prince as a cultivated and universal man, but required people able to function very well, the functionaries, to have specific roles and tasks in the government. And in front of the of this idea, Huarte developed the Galenic tradition, especially the quod animi mores temperamenta sequantur, which is quoted by him as his main inspiration. Starting from Galen, he developed a theory of education, which is that your body determines your abilities, and it is unnecessary to program on a state level both your birth, so the ability to have an influence on which are your abilities based on the body, and then about the selection of talents, so that no one studies something for which he hasn't no ability or no talent. And then education can do little, can only develop, cannot change your talents or attitudes. This is the work, this is the font matter of the first edition, which was printed in 1575, by Huarte himself. He paid for this print. This is a very simple book, not so high quality in its paper and in its appearance. This is the Spanish edition, but this book enjoyed for one century a lot of a lot of edition in different languages. Here we can see the Italian version, 1582, the English translation, which was translated in English, reading from the Italian, and this is the translation published in 1594, from which we are going to read passages today. And so these two translations in the same century, and also the French edition, Lyon, 1580. Later, the Dutch translation, and Amsterdam. And we finish here, but we have also the Latin and also other translations. This was a work who really enjoyed great diffusion, while the author wasn't so lucky, and he died very poor because he never had the official license from the Catholic Church for his work. It was banned and put at the index, done a corrigatur. It means unless you don't do the corrections. But he never wanted to do the correction required, and the edition with the correction required by the church was published after his death by his sons. So, which are the key concepts of Huarte's assessment of talents? We told before that individual bodily temperament is the only source of one's own abilities. You can't learn anything if you don't have a disposition, if your body allowing you to do it. So you are predetermined from birth on which abilities and activities you will be able to develop. Of course, if you have received a good education, you can develop these abilities. If you don't, you cannot, but you cannot change the path and your destination. For this reason, you shouldn't choose what you want to do as a citizen. Your educational path and your profession should be chosen according to your abilities assessed by a doctor on the basis of the analysis of temperament. You can have a prevalent mixture, hot, humid, or hot, dry, or cold, humid. We don't have cold, dry because Huarte says, with coldness and dryness, you will be dead. So your brain won't function anymore. But with three combination mixtures, you can determine which is your prevalent mental ability. If you are hot and humid, you will have a prevalent imagination. You will be an artist, but also a leader, but also a person with practical attitude. Hot, dry, you will have intellect, so you will be speculative, reflective, philosopher, and also any activity which require to be detached from the material world. And cold, humid, you will have memory, so you can be good in languages, in law, all abilities which require memory, and also is prevalent in women because women are more cold and humid, especially more humid than men. So they won't be able to, except in some cases, to develop great imagination or intellect, but they will normally have greater memory. And also, this temperament changes slightly, not in its basis, but changes slightly with age. So as a child, you will be, of course, more humid and will be learned by memory easier. And then with age, your memory will go drier and unable to process a lot of information. L'education, we have said, loses power. You won't be able to change the nature of your pupil, but only to develop it. And parents should program the talents of the child, ask themselves, how do we want our son or daughter to be? Which will be his or her profession, and then act in the act of reproduction according to indication given by the doctor Huarte on how to develop specific talents in the child. And all this, it is at the service of the Res Publica. You don't do it for yourself or or to enjoy your ability, but also to find your place in the development of a functioning and well-functioning state. This is explained by Ward at the beginning, at the very beginning of the book. Here we read, as we said before, from the English edition. And here he says, to the end that artificers may attain the perfection required for the use of the Commonwealth, so the end is to find perfection for the use of the Commonwealth, methinks, Catholic Royal Majesty. The book is as a dedication to Philip II. A law should be enacted that no carpenter should exercise himself in any work which appertain to the occupation of an husbandman, nor a tailor to that of an architect, and that the advocate should not minister physic, nor the physician play the advocate, but each one exercise only that art to which he beareth a natural inclination, and let pass the rest of it. So, everyone should exercise the art to which he beareth a natural inclination, not any other. If you do differently, you won't succeed, and you'll be useless for the state. And here, this is not the same text, it's another paragraph. And here he says, now to the end, he may not err in choosing that which fitteth best with his own nature. Anyone cannot do anything bad when he chooses what it fitteth best his own nature. There should be deputed in the Commonwealth men of great wisdom and knowledge, who might discover each one's wit in his tender age, and cause him perforce to study that science which is agreeable to study that science which is agreeable for him, not permitting him to make his own choice. So the Commonwealth, the state, should appoint men, very, very expert talent scouts, so we would say today, who might discover each one's fit in his tender age. We'll examine children and say who has which talent is good for each child, and cause him perforce to study that science which is agreeable for him. You have a good intellect, so we will study philosophy or medicine. You have a good imagination, you will be artist, artisan. You work with your hands, or you will you can be a good leader. But you cannot choose. You shouldn't choose, because if you choose, you can you serve yourself. You don't serve the state, and it is not good according to Ward. Whence this good would ensue your state as signories, that in them should reside the rest artificer of the world, and their workers should be of the greatest perfection, for not else than because they united art and nature. Of course, we have to remember, we have under Philip II in Spain, there is no idea whatsoever of democracy, of liberty. This is totally out of Ward's scope of mind. But he says them, if people is not even free, anybody is free to choose his own profession, but let's do it according to nature and the body, and let's not do it according to the social class. He often says we shouldn't follow this social class. There are a lot of peasants that should be philosophers, and a lot of professors that should be peasants and go to the fields, but unfortunately we cannot do it, but we should. Ward says that there should be no freedom, but nobody enjoyed the freedom at his time, but this should be made according to nature. And for Ward, the brain is the organic site of the operation of the soul. This is not new, or completely new, of course, in the history of medicine. But Ward asserts this with great clarity, and also makes a reflection on in which sites of the brain single facultys are located. So it postulates a completely physical nature of soul activities. He says also when we have a brain injury, we lose memory, intellect, or imagination of all three of them. So it doesn't, it means that perhaps soul is immortal. What doesn't want to have too many problems, but the church didn't take it. But he says, I don't know if the soul if mortal, probably certainly it is. But the faculty of the brain of the soul work only in the body and in the functioning brain. So perhaps soul if it is immortal, I didn't, it doesn't work. It works only when it is physically located in a brain which is able to function through imagination, intellect, and memory. Here he speaks about Hippocrates and Plato. He says, but these two great philosophers, Hippocrates and Plato, coming into the world, gave evidence that this opinion was false. The idea, the previous idea that the heart was the site of emotion and operation of the soul, which says, what he says is the opinion of the ancient philosopher before Plato, but also of the Bible. So he is saying that Bible is wrong. This was a little problematic for him at the time. He says the opinion was false and proved by many reasons and experiments that the brain is the principal seat of the reasonable soul. And so they all gave hands to this opinion, save only Aristotle, who, with the purpose of crossing Plato in all points, turned to revive the former opinion, and with topical place to make it probable. He says everyone was agreed with Plato and Hippocrates that not the heart, but the brain is site of the activity of the soul. Only Aristotle remained with the opinion of the heart, but only because he wanted to contradict Plato any time. He often quotes Aristotle, but normally when he finds something different between Aristotle and Plato, he stays with Plato normally. Which of this opinion the truth swayeth, time serve not now to discuss. For there is none of this philosopher that doubts but that the brain is the instrument ordained by nature, to the end that the man might become wise and skillful. It sufficeth only to declare with what condition this part ought to be endowed, so as we may affirm that it is duly instrumentalized, that a young man in his behalf may possess, ci fermiamo. Let's stop here the reading, but let's go with which were the qualities that a brain had to have in order to function well. Four conditions that the brain ought to enjoy. To the end, the reasonable soul may therewith commodiously perform the works which appertain to understanding and wisdom. The first, good composition. So the matter of the brain physically should be have a good composition and have a be constructed in a way to work, and we will see later. The second, that his part are be well united, the ventricles of the brain. He says there are three ventricles, and then the cerebellum, the back, the fourth part of the brain, his part will be united. The third, that the heat exceed not the cold, not the moist, the dry. There can be different temperaments of the brain, we will say later. You can have a brain which is hotter, a brain which is more humid, a brain which is drier, but not so much to exceed heat or moist that the brain doesn't work anymore. And the fourth, that this substance be made of parts subtile and very delicate, that this substance is not rough, but is soft and delicate. And this is important because the activities he recommends to couples so that they can generate children with a good intellect or good wisdom are only these or these rules focus on the goal to have a brain which is made of good substance and subtle, not too heavy substance, not so the day before the conception, not to eat meat, too heavy meat, not to drink too much, but drink white wine. There are all the food advice for the couples. In the good composition are contained other four things. The first is good figure, the second quantity sufficient, the third, the timbre, the four ventricles be distinct and severed, each duly bestowed in a certain place, therefore, that the capableness of this be neither greater nor less than is convenient. And he explains here better the good figure, so it is really the physical constitution of the brain which commands and regulates all our emotions, talents, and abilities. He asks himself, where are located the single faculties? Where is memory? Where is intellect? Where is imagination in the brain? He says, with this self-power of the soul, we understand, imagine, and remember. But if it be true that every work requires a particular instrument, it behoves of necessity that within the brain there be one instrument for the understanding, one for the imagination, and another different from them for the memory. For if all the brain were instrumentalized after one self manner, either the whole should be memory, or the whole understanding, or the whole imagination. He says, but we have the different faculties should be distinct in our brain. There is not the idea of a soul which can change its attitudes and change its activity, and so that be flexible. He says we have a brain, and inside we have to have three different tools. But these tools, he says, at the end, he says there are not distinct in the single ventricles. Each ventricles are the three faculties together, the three instruments inside. Why? Since then, all the three ventricles are their own self-composition, physically, the brain substance, the brain matter is the same. And that there rests not amongst them any variety of parts, they are very similar, the ventricles. We may not live to take the first qualities for an instrument and to make many general difference on which, as they are in number. For to think that the reasonable soul being the body can work without some bodily instrument to assist her against all natural philosophy. If we think that the reasonable soul can work in the body without some bodily instruments, is against philosophy. We have to accept that our soul functions only because it has a physical organ and it needs it to function. But of the four qualities, heat, cold, moisture, and dry, all physicians leave out cold as unprofitable to any operation of the reasonable soul, and then explains why. So, his conclusion is that we don't have a ventricle for each ability, but we have more memory or more intellect or more imagination connected to which is our prevalent temperament of the brain. So if the brain is hot, humid, or cold, humid, or cold, or hot, dry. So here we summarize the material conception of faculties by Huarte. So the faculties reside in the brain and function because of it. Our soul cannot do nothing without the brain as physical organ. All ventricles of the brain contain the three faculties, intellect, imagination, and memory. Any brain damage impacts on the three faculties, which are therefore embedded in matter. If I have a brain damage, I lose the three faculties, more or less, because I can't do anything without the physical matter of the brain. And the difference between the three faculties does not reside in the brain substance itself, but in its temperament, prevalence of all dry, hot humid, and cold humid. So we go to the other section of this presentation that is about pre-eugenics or eugenics, we can say. And so the chapter 15 and the last chapter of the work speaks about in what manner parents may budget wise children and offer wit fit for learning. So how can parents choose the talents of their children? And it's good if they have children fit for learning because the state requires wise men and learned men. He says, if I thought of a matter worthy of marvel, that nature being such as we all know her, wise, witty, and of great art, judgment, and force, and mankind a work of so special regard, yet for one whom he makes skillful and wise, she produced infinite deprived of wit. Nature is so good, is so marvelous, but it produces so many people without any intelligence, without many abilities. The book starts at the beginning on chapter one with the example of Marco, son of Cicero, that of whom what says the father, this great philosopher and orator, provided him with the best books, with the best teachers. He sent him to Athens, made for him everything to learn, but he didn't learn anything. It remained stupid. Why remained him stupid? Because he didn't have the right composition of the brain and the right temperament for philosophy. And when it is like this, you can do anything. And later he says, we can explain it because the father was so concentrated in philosophy and in his doctrine that when he had intercourse with the women, it wasn't not so concentrated and he wasn't attentive to generate good children. So it was not important to him. He didn't have an intelligent child. He says, on which effect myself searching the reason natural cause have found in my judgment that parents apply not themselves to an act of generation with that order and concert which is by nature established. Nature wants you to apply yourself to generation following certain rules. If you don't, the body of your child won't be apt to learning and won't have the right disposition, and so you have children which are either not good for a profession they will do in the future, or worse, unable to learn anything. And then he goes back to his favorite authors, Plato, Hippocrates, and Galen. And he says, to come then to the first point we have already alleged, that Plato laid down how in a well-ordered commonwealth there ought to be assigned certain surveyors of marriages, who by art might skill to look into the quality of the person that are to be married, and to give each one the wife which answereth in proportion, and to every wife a convenient husband. He says, also Plato said that we had to choose couples for generations so that they were adapted the one to the other. In which matter, Hippocrates and Galen began to take some pains and prescribe certain precepts and rules to know what woman is fruitful and who can bear no children, and what man is unable for generation, how able and likely to beget issue. But touching all this, they utter very little, and that not which such distinction as was be awful, at least for the purpose which I have in hand. He said, I have a lot of information from Hippocrates and Galen on the rules of generation and how to have healthy children and to have children at all. But I don't have anything on how to regulate conception in order to generate children which are mainly intellectual, mainly imaginative, mainly full of memory, and which are apt to specific profession. I don't have this in my author, so I'll do it myself. And here I summarize that what we said before, the parents have the duty to observe all rules to produce intelligent and wise children. The rules are provided by the physician and are focused to acquire an adequate substance for the brain, an adequate temperament for the full profession of the child. A conception should be programmed with this aim. The state should take care of this task, even across social classes. If there, the state needs more intellectuals, and these intellectuals are not to be found in the ruling class because there aren't men and women with the right temperament to generate good children, intellectual children, we should look at other social classes and, if necessary, go to the peasants, go to the workers and find them people apt for philosophy, for politics, and for medicine, which is, of course, for Duarte, the most important discipline because it supervises the Republic, as philosophy was for Plato, is medicine for Duarte. Duarte speaks about medicine and natural philosophy and says that that is the most high and important discipline. Religion cannot help in this. You can pray, Duarte says, you can pray how much you want, you can ask for miracles, but religion cannot help because, he says, God follows the rules of nature. God has made nature with rules, and God himself follows these rules of his creation. Sometimes you can do miracles once in a thousand years for special reasons, but normally God himself follows the nature's rules, so you can pray whatever you want, but you can't go beyond these rules. And education can act only in the development of the given faculties and talents. So you, as a state, you can establish the best universities, the best high schools, the best teach, appoint the best teachers, but this is important, but useless if you don't work on assessment and selection of individual talents. And here I conclude the presentation with the first paragraph. Here I transcribe it in Spanish because it's also funny and a good language to be read. I'm not good at reading in Spanish, so I leave it for you. But this is the beginning when he says Cicerone wanted to educate Caio Marco the best way, but he wasn't able to do it because the child had no talent. So he salì un gran nescio, con poca eloquenza e menos filosofia. He wasn't nor intelligent, nor eloquent, nor a philosopher. And this idea was considered, this view of education was considered so important by the Jesuits, which were among the first readers of this book, that they took Duarte's theory for the mechanism of selection in the Jesuit, in the first Jesuit colleges. We have documents that say that an officer in the Jesuits made the analysis of talents and on an Duarte's basis and assigned single members of the order to specific tasks. Possevino, one of the most the first Jesuit educators, in his Cultura degli Ingegni, followed the Examen de Ingenios, clearly, he said, yes, we follow Duarte as far as the selection, the assessment and selection of talent is concerned. We don't follow him anymore on the fact that education is not important and free choice is not important, because we have to affirm that free will, libero arbitrio, is a stake of Catholic doctrine in the age in which Protestantism said that we don't have free will, we have predestination. The Catholic Church affirmed the role of free will, and so Possevino say we accept Duarte's theory, but we don't accept the idea that you cannot, with your free will and with your prayers, change your destination, your natural destination. You can change, your will can go against nature, but normally admits for Savino, it's good to follow one's own individual talent and educate according to the body, because it's the body that produces the ability.